Hare Krishna. Welcome to Weekend Wisdom Series on Bhagavad Gita. We are continuing our discussion on Chapter 9, The Most Confidential Knowledge. In the last session, we had covered up to verse 25, and today we'll begin from 26 onwards, and we'll try to conclude Chapter 9 today itself. So, the theme of today's discussion is, how can we please Krishna? And if we learn the art of how can we really please Krishna, and if we progressively work on that art, then practically there is nothing else remains for us to really please in this world. So let's look at Shloka 26, and we'll read 26, 27 and 28 together, because all these three shlokas have the same theme. So Shloka 26, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam Yome Bhaktya Prayachati. Translation: if one offers me with love and devotion a leaf, a flower, a fruit or water, I will accept it. So here in this Shloka 26 and 27 and 28, we'll be discussing three main questions. First is, what Krishna really wants us to offer him, or what can we really give to Krishna? Then second question is, why do we really need to give something to Krishna? Why do we need to offer something to Krishna? And then the third question is that, what would be the outcome or the result of those offerings that we'll make to Krishna? So three questions we'll deal in Shloka 26, 27 and 28. So 26 and 27 is focused on the theme on what can we really give to Krishna. Then 28 is on what is the outcome and why do we really need to offer something to Krishna. So in 26, Krishna is telling that there are four things that you can offer me. One is flower, fruit, leaf and water. So these are the four things that Krishna is telling us to offer. So let's take an example of a flower or rose. Now rose is something that a boy would always like to offer to his girlfriend, and likewise a girl would like to offer this flower to her boyfriend, and they would like to offer the best flower to each other. So we may question that if we can simply offer fruit, water, flower and leaf to Krishna, then why do we really need to make so much arrangements? Because we want to offer best to God, because we love God. So that is why at times we see that devotees make elaborate and best arrangement for God. It is out of love. They want to offer more and more. And that's how one of the symptoms of love is that there is an exchange. The exchange takes place between the lover and the beloved. So likewise, devotees also exchange different things with God. So what can we really offer to Krishna? In Shloka 26, Krishna mentioned the four items that we can offer to Krishna. Let's look at Shloka 27. There Krishna says, Yat karoshi, yat ashnashi, yat juhasi, dadasi yat, yat tapasyasi kaunteya, tat kurushav mad arpanam. Translation: whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever you offer or give away, and whatever austerities you perform, do that, O son of Kunti, as an offering to me. So here it is starting with very important word. It says that whatever you do, so that means action. Whatever action we perform, that action should be performed as an offering to God. Whatever we eat in life, again, that should be first given to Krishna. That should be offered to Krishna. So how can we give our actions to Krishna? By offering the results of the actions to Krishna. So very simple. Then Krishna says, whatever austerities you perform, so those austerities should also be mean to offer me. So everything should be dovetailed in our life in a manner that it is mean to please Krishna. It is mean to serve Krishna. It is mean to give something to Krishna. And in today's challenging world, the most important thing that we can give among many other things of this world is time, because we do not have time. And if we can spare out some time during the day, and if we can use that time wisely to serve Krishna, to please Krishna, to know about Krishna, then our life is successful. So we answered here the first question, what Krishna really wants us to offer him, or what can we really give to him. The second question, why Krishna really wants us to offer him. On one side, he is Purnam, everything is coming from him. In fact, whatever we have in our possession, that also comes from Krishna. Then why do we really need to offer him? He doesn't really need anything from us. We can understand it again with the help of an example. Just like when there is a love between a father and a child, then the child out of love at times gives something to father. Even if the father is full and everything has been provided to the child by the father, but still he would love to take it because it is being given by the child to the father. He may not be ready to eat it, but just to please, or just out of love, because of the loving exchange between the father and the child, the father accepts the food being offered by the son. So similarly, everything comes from Krishna, God is Purnam, but out of love, Krishna is ready to accept what we offer him. That is how loving exchanges takes place between the devotees. So then the third question that comes here is, why Krishna really wants us to offer him or give him? So Krishna is answering this in Shloka 28. He says that in this way you will be freed from bondage to work and its auspicious and inauspicious results. With your mind fixed on me in this principle of renunciation, you will be liberated and come to me. So we know that every action has an equal and opposite reaction, and it creates a cycle, the rippling effect. Even if we do something good, then also we have to, you know, enjoy the benefit, enjoy the fruit of that action. And if we do something bad or inauspicious, then also we have to suffer with the repercussions of that wrong action that we perform. So what is the outcome? Here Krishna is telling that if you give me something, if you try to offer everything that you do in your life to me, then the outcome is that you will become free from the bondage of work. Because whatever action we are doing, whatever work we are performing, it will again bind us in this world. For that Krishna is telling, please offer me so that you can come back to me. You will become liberated, your mind will always be fixed. You will always think about how to render service. So in Shloka 34, the last Shloka of the day, there Krishna is talking about how can we engage our mind in the service of Krishna. We'll discuss more there. So here we discuss the three questions. What Krishna really wants us to offer, why Krishna wants us to offer him, what would be the outcome of those offerings. So now let's move on to Shloka 29. Sammoham sarva bhuteshu name deshu asti na priya ye bhajanti tu mam bhaktya maite teshu chapayam. Translation, I envy no one, nor am I partial to anyone. I am equal to all, but whoever renders service unto me in devotion is a friend, is in me, and I am also a friend to him. So here Krishna is telling that Sammoham sarva bhuteshu, that means first thing is that he is not partial to anyone. He is equal to all. Now someone will say that why then God is treating differently with different people. Here we have an interesting example again. Just like if you go to a shopkeeper in the market, and depending on your budget, let's say if you have a budget of 1,000 rupees, then shopkeeper will give you different things. And if someone comes who has a budget of 5,000 rupees, then the shopkeeper would deal with him differently, or he will offer him different things based on his budget. So similarly, Krishna is actually not treating differently. It is just how we reciprocate with him. So in fact, the shopkeeper is not making any differentiation. Shopkeeper is not really partial. He's just dealing differently based on what the customer want, based on how the customer is approaching to the shopkeeper. Likewise, the way we approach to God, that way God reciprocates with us. So he's not really partial to anyone. He is equal to everyone. Krishna is telling that he is a friend in me and I am a friend to him. He's saying that I am his friend and he is my friend. So we both are friend to each other. Like for example, if someone is a friend of a very influential person in this world, maybe the politically influential person, let's say Mr. Modi, then practically that person is, you know, whatever work he or she may need, then that person can easily get the work done through that person. So in this verse, one word is very important. There it is mentioned as Ye Bhajanti Tu. That means that we have to offer some service, and that service would lead to cultivation of love for God. Initially, it may happen that we may not be able to cultivate our love immediately for God. No problem. At least we should perform some service with rules and regulations, and that will be a gradual move towards cultivation of our love for Krishna. So the theme of 29 is that Krishna is not partial to anyone. It is just on our side how we want him to reciprocate with us, because he never wants to force anyone. If you will love, or if you will approach to love him to this proportion, then he will respond to this proportion. But if you are not going to approach him, then he's also sitting and he's waiting, man, this fellow is going to approach me. Let's move on to shloka 30 and 31. Now again, this is a very important shloka. Here we can see some good encouragement coming in from God. Api cheta sudura charo bhajate mam ananya bhak sadhureva samantavya samya gavya vasito hisam. Even if one commits the most abominable action, if he is engaged in devotional service, he is to be considered saintly because he is properly situated in his determination. So here we have an interesting word again, sudura charo. Sudura charo means we see at times that, you know, devotees who are practicing Krishna consciousness or who are trying to understand God, they sometimes fall down from their position, or they perform some abominable action or some sinful act which they should not perform, because those actions do not really suit to the behavior of one who is practicing Krishna consciousness. So first principle is that temporary fall down of a person never disqualifies him from practicing Krishna consciousness. It may happen that there can be some lapses when we are practicing Krishna consciousness, but we should not really be over conscious of it, that oh, why this person has did it, he is practicing this Hare Krishna and all of a sudden he is doing this nonsense activity. No, Krishna is giving an excuse. Krishna is excusing them. Krishna is telling them, okay, they are still considered to be saintly because their determination is fixed on devotional service. So they can be temporary lapses, but we should not really make them as a benchmark of evaluating their devotional status. Because we know that the process of devotion is a gradual activity. It does not really lead one person to reach up to the perfection overnight. We are sure that we will reach to the perfection, but that could happen eventually. So we can again understand it with the help of an example. Just like there is a moon, and we know that moon has a lot of spots, but those spots never become impediments to the diffusion of the moonlight that comes onto the earth. So spots are there, still moon is performing its functions irrespective of those dark spots on it. So, but here one warning that we should always remember in our mind. Here Krishna is talking about accidental fall down. So when we say accidental fall down, it does not mean that in the guise of this verse, we keep on committing sinful activities and in parallel we keep on performing devotional service. We should not think that, okay, now Krishna has given us leverage. So here Krishna does not really want us to do anything and everything that we want in terms of the sinful activities along with the devotional service. Krishna's focus is that, okay, fine, there can be some temporary lapses, but those lapses should not be just the benchmark of our spiritual life. Now let's move on to verse 31. In verse 31, Krishna is telling to Arjuna, Kaunteya pratijanihi name bhaktya pranashyati. Translation, he quickly becomes righteous and attains lasting peace. O son of Kunti, declare it boldly that my devotee never perishes. So here Krishna is telling that, okay, fine, you know, people who have committed abominable actions, but if they are determined on the path of devotional service, then eventually they will become righteous and virtuous in their life. And then Krishna is giving assurance through Arjuna that declare it boldly to the world that my devotee never perishes. So there might be temporary lapses, but ultimately we are sure that we are going to go back to Krishna. Krishna will help us to get out of those, you know, temporary lapses from our practice of spiritual life. So this is a devotee's promise. In fact, this is not a direct promise that's coming from God, because Krishna at times might break his promise. But he's telling Arjuna that you declare, because Krishna knows that he cannot break the promise that he gives to his devotee. So Krishna, through the words of Arjuna, is assuring that a devotee is not going to destroy ever, because he has taken to the path of devotional service. He has given his life to understand me, and it's not easy. We see a lot of people that they are so much busy in so many other things of this world, but they do not have time for God. But a devotee is at least trying to give his time to understand God. And that is his qualification. That is why Krishna wants to protect his devotees. Krishna is always looking forward for the options through which Krishna can take care of his devotees, or those who take shelter of him. Because not everyone is taking shelter of him. And that's the rarest of the rare opportunity if we take shelter of Krishna in our life. In verse 32 and 33, the theme is that no matter whatever background a person may be from, he is eligible to perform devotional service, irrespective of the status, background, caste, community, sex. It does not matter. Everyone is equally eligible to take part in the devotional service. There is no categorization that, okay, if one is Brahmana, then only a Brahmana can do devotional service. Now let's move on to the most important shloka of the day that you may all please recite with me, and that would be the concluding discussion on chapter 9. It's a very famous shloka, and here Krishna is talking about some of the practical tips of how can we engage our mind in the service of Krishna. Mame veshyasi yukta vevam atmanam matparayana. Engage your mind always in thinking of me, become my devotee, offer obeisances to me and worship me. Being completely absorbed in me, surely you will come to me. So we see that our mind is thinking at every moment. We always want to do something. Even if when we are taking rest, that time also we see that at times the mind is functioning. When we are dreaming, We sleep, but the mind does not really sleep at times. So mind is constantly thinking about doing something or other. And this is the natural position of our mind. So now here Krishna is telling that always think of me. Then Krishna says, become my devotee. And then further Krishna says that worship me, offer me obeisances. Someone will say, why Krishna is just talking about doing everything for him? Because Krishna is telling that I want you to come to me. I am waiting for you. I am looking forward to that day and you will come to me. So that is why Krishna is again and again, some way or other, he is just trying to call us back to him. And that's why Krishna wants us to become his devotees. We can understand it with the help of an example. Just like in the office, there is a boss and there is a subordinate to him. A subordinate focus is always about how he can please his or her boss. Like a servant is always thinking about how to please the master. Likewise, a devotee is always thinking about how to please Krishna. This word is mean to divert our attention to many other things other than Krishna. But we all have to stay focused on rendering service to Krishna. Now, service is a very wide subject. There can be a lot of things that can come within the gamut of service. So one of the area of service is hearing. Like if you are hearing this message of Bhagavad Gita, that means you are rendering service to Krishna. If you are chanting the holy names of Krishna, that means you are rendering service to Krishna. If I am speaking about Krishna to you, that means you are rendering service to Krishna. I am rendering service to Krishna. So we all together have to render some service to Krishna. That will please Krishna. Krishna does not really need anything from us, but Krishna wants that we should love him. And that love would be in our favor only. That is why he is again and again stressing on the need of a devotee to render service to him. So we are concluding our discussion for today now. So in Shloka 26, 27 and 28, we discussed on the theme of offering or giving something to Krishna. We discussed why do we need to give something to Krishna, how it will really help us in our life, what is the objective of giving something to Krishna. Because whatever action we perform in life, we must have a clarity why are we performing that action. If we do not have a clarity, then there is no point of performing that action in the life. In Shloka 29, Krishna said that he is not partial to anyone. He is equal to all. And whosoever renders service unto him, then he becomes friend to him. In 30 and 31, Krishna is saying that, you know, ultimately, if you are performing devotional service with determination, no problem. Accidental fall down is acceptable. Still, one would be considered as sadhu, but it should not be a repetitive exercise. In the last verse 34, we discuss about the importance of service. God is talking about different means and ways of how we can serve him. Engagement of mind by thinking about him. To think about him means to know about him. To know about him means to read what he has said. Like in Bhagavad Gita, he has mentioned many things. Then there are so many pastimes of the Lord that we can go through from Bhagavatam. Then Krishna says, you can worship me. And Krishna says, you can offer obeisances to me. In this way, surely you are going to come back to me. Krishna wants us to go back to him. With this note, we are concluding our discussion on chapter 9, the most confidential knowledge, where the entire focus of Krishna is that service, service and service. And through that service, you will come to me, you will come to me and you will come to me. If we learn to obey the instructions of God, then we will ultimately enjoy. But if we do not obey the instruction of God, we will ultimately suffer. God knows what is our ultimate welfare. And He's always looking for the opportunity that, okay, my son, please come to me now. Just follow some instructions. You will enjoy life with me. You will eternally live with me in my kingdom and you will stay happy and peaceful. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Srimad Bhagavad Gita Ki Jai.